So today we're going to be talking about regeneration methods, a brief introduction to regen methods. And so with this topic, what I want to focus it on a little bit more is not just the 8 regeneration methods that we're going to learn this semester, but why we see different prevalences of those different 8 regeneration methods actually apply here in the southern U.S. and in East Texas in particular. And so with our regen methods, we're starting this first unit of the course where the whole focus of the course is going to be on regeneration methods. So what we're going to do, we're going to cover clear cutting next lecture, then we're going to cover seed tree in a lecture, shelter wood in a lecture, then we're going to spend one lecture on both of our two-age systems, then we're going to spend two lectures on our uneven age systems, our selection silvicultural systems, and the first lecture will be focused on the systems themselves. And the second lecture will be focused on what we call regulation methods, which are quantitative tools we can use to decide how many trees to harvest at each entry within a selection system. And so we'll be spanning both intensive and extensive silvicultural systems here, and we'll really be talking about all aspects, ecological, economic, and societal. And so there are 8 silvicultural systems. And so what I want you to do to start with is see if you can work in a pair, keep 6 feet apart. But what I want you to do is look at those 8 silvicultural systems and put together a list. And what I want you to do, you can abbreviate them, CC for clear cut, ST for seed tree, however you want to abbreviate them is fine, you don't have to write them out. But put them in a list from 1 to 8 in terms of how common you think each one of these is in East Texas. So start with the most common and work your way to the least common, okay? So go ahead and split up and work on that for a few minutes. So ordinarily I'd have you write them up on the board and we could compare everyone's list, but in this classroom we have a tiny little whiteboard and no markers. So just a show of hands, who has clear cutting as their most common system? And everybody's got their hand up, right? So we can kind of all agree on that. I don't actually have the right answer for you for East Texas, the South, or the US. I've never actually seen data on this. And what we call silvicultural systems will vary a little bit depending on where you are in the country, and the terminology evolves a little bit over time. So we're just kind of guessing at what the right answer is, but we certainly see a lot of clear cuts here in East Texas, and you know, it'd be pretty surprising if that wasn't the most common. Okay, so now just go ahead and say out loud, what was your least common system? Everybody, go. So I'm hearing some seed trees, some selection systems. We do occasionally see some seed tree systems out there. They probably would have been much more common before we had a lot of nurseries where we could buy a lot of planted seedlings. And so seed tree would have been much more common in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s in this part of the world than it is today. We're gonna look at a good comparison between clear cutting and seed tree approach today, so we can look at some of the pros and cons between the two and see why we've probably shifted more to clear cutting away from seed trees. There is some Forest Service research right now looking at how we can take the seed tree approach, and a lot of our understanding of it comes from 1930, 1940, 1950, but how we can take that with our southern pines and now deploy modern silvicultural tools along with that regeneration method. So what happens if you do a seed tree cut, but then you also use herbicides, so you make sure that you're controlling your non-pine vegetation? What if you also then do series of thinnings, maybe even fertilizer application? Can we make that seed tree much more of a competitive system compared to clear cutting if the landowner's objective is timber management and financial gain? So there's some interesting research out there. I heard a number of folks say different selection systems. If I was putting a list together myself, I'd probably throw single tree selection at the end there. And there's a good reason for that. For single tree selection to work, you need to have a very, very shade tolerant species that can make it into the overstory and then be desirable to meet your management objectives. And that tree really doesn't exist here in the southern United States. So if you look, a lot of our landowners want to manage for oaks and want to manage for pines. Those are the two most common taxa that we see folks managing for. The pines are all intolerant of shade, and the oaks are all intermediate to intolerant of shade. And so we don't have that species like sugar maple in the northern United States, like potentially western red cedar out in the western United States. So we just don't have a species with the right combination of silvics. And then where you put everything in the middle between the two extremes, you know, we're all going to have slightly different lists. Generally, when we see these all up on the board, people have shelter woods kind of high up. I have seen shelter woods operationally deployed here in East Texas for hardwood management, but definitely still not as common as clear cutting. So kind of a good way to get you started thinking about these different systems. Okay. And so what I want to do today here is work our way through this one publication on a comparison between pine plantations and seed tree cuts. So we're going to look at a number of tables here that are breaking down similar data. So let's get you started by looking at this table, and I'll go over sort of what the study is and what the different treatments are. Then we'll start looking at these different numbers on here. And again, if you're having trouble seeing the slides, I'm going to post these so you'll be able to look at these in a lot more detail. So basically, from the top of that list to the bottom, they have six options that they tried out. This was done not far from here at Hill Farm, Louisiana. And those six options kind of increase in silvicultural intensity. So you start with a seed tree, and you can see they tried three different options on the seed tree. They did two different mechanical site prep options, where in one of them they dissed it, in another they burned it. And the point of that disking or burning is you cut all but, you know, 5 or 10 trees breaker that are going to produce seed for you. And then those treatments were intended to prepare the seed bed. So you would get seed coming off your pines and they would have a good chance to germinate and establish that next cohort. Remember, this was all with loblolly pine. So remember, with loblolly pine, any of our southern pines, that seed needs good contact with mineral soil in order to germinate. They're not going to be successful if you just have them landing on top of a thick litter loop. Okay, and then you see the planted stands, three different options of planted stands. And basically they kind of go in increasing order of silvicultural intensity. And you can kind of think of them, if you want, as a 1960s plantation, a 1970s plantation, and then a 1980s plantation in terms of the treatments they deployed and when those treatments became commonly used in pine plantation silviculture in the US South. So the first one, they planted a lot of trees breaker. They planted 1200 trees breaker. So over time, we've gone from planting about 1,200 trees per acre in the 1950s or so, down to today where our southwide average planting density is much closer to 500 trees per acre. So we used to plant a lot more trees per acre, and then the MS is mechanical site prep. Before the 1970s, herbicides were not commonly used in forestry in the South, and before the 60s, they weren't really used at all. And so your best bet for competition control was some sort of mechanical site prep. Go through and shear or use a treatment called a roller chopper, where you drag a big dozer through a stand. It's got this huge drum, metal drum behind it with fins sticking out. You fill it with like 8 tons of water and that chops up everything on your site. And then you burn it and you keep your fingers crossed that you're not gonna get too many hardwoods. It was hit or miss on how well it worked, but that was their best option at the time. So that's an option with no chemical site prep at all. Below that, sort of our 1970s silviculture, they're planting it at a lower density, 680 trees per acre, but they are applying herbicides, and in that case, chemical site prep is focused on control of woody species. We often think of dividing our herbicide treatments into two broad categories, those that primarily control woody competitors and those that primarily control herbaceous competitors, okay? So that was a woody competition control. And then our bottom option is our most intensive silvicultural approach in this data. And so they planted it at that same 680 trees per acre. They used CS, chemical site prep, so that's our woody control. And then they added HWS, that's herbaceous weed suppression. So they also treated the non-woody competitors. Now, when you do that, you really only need to do it for the first couple of years. Think about that FOSHI first 2018 stand that we were out on in lab on Tuesday, where once you had the pine trees up above that layer of competing vegetation, the pines would be fine, you wouldn't be worried about that. But we saw the pines weren't above it, so that would be a good example of maybe you need some of that herbaceous weed control. So how they did this study is also kind of interesting. The top three treatments, the seed trees, those were plantations, those were naturally regenerated stands through a seed tree established out at Hill Farm. They grew them up through maturity And then they ended up clear cutting them, and it should say it for you right here on the bottom right. And so the sea tree stands were established in 1955. They grew them out to 1984, and then they clear cut them. And then those plantation treatments they established on that same site. So all of these treatments, we're talking about the same site. So there's not going to be any site differences accounting for any of the differences we're seeing here. It's two rotations on one site. Okay, so there's some of the background on this study for you, but it's a great study to help us compare plantations and seed tree cuts. So let's start looking at the actual data now. Okay, and so what are some of the differences right off the bat that you see between the seed trees and the plantations that stand out? So look at diameters there. And so what we'll notice in that DBH inches column for diameters, you're at 3.5 on all the seed tree options, and your plantations are all in the 6 to 7 range. So our diameters are significantly larger on the plantations. What else do you notice? Yeah, the heights. Would you expect that? Has site index changed? It's the same site, right? So you have the same amount of nutrients in the soil, you have the same rough amount of water availability, the climate's gonna be very similar. And yet what you notice here on that second from the far right column, that the plantations are all 42 to 47 feet tall, and those seed tree cuts are all, what are they, 32, 33 feet tall? So let's think a little bit more about what is accounting for those differences in heights. So what factors might be playing into that comparison? So stand density, when we look at stand density, there's actually a really good study that the Plantation Management Research Cooperative put in Georgia, where they planted stands on 6 different densities ranging from 300 trees per acre on up to 1800 trees per acre. And then they had 2 levels of silviculture. One, they managed them sort of silviculture as we would see operationally in the field. And the other was a maximum silviculture approach where they used a lot of fertilizer, a lot of herbicides to really grow those trees as well as they could. And what they found there is within that range between basically 0 and 2,000 trees per acre, that density didn't really impact height very much. And there's another way we can think about that too. So you all have used site index curves and biometrics, ecology, other classes, we'll use them in here as well. So when you look at a site index curve, where's density reflected on the site index curve? So a site index curve is showing you height on the y-axis and stand age in years on the x-axis. So where's density on there? It's not on there, right? Okay, and so if density was significantly impacting height, you would have to have a different site index curve for each density, and site index wouldn't be as useful a tool for us. Now, all that being said, if you get up to extreme densities, 50,000 trees per acre, what you may see is that each tree has so little of the resources on that site, it's competing so intensely that height growth rates can actually stall out. And stands at extreme densities like that may be pretty low vigor and very susceptible to drought, insects, disease, all sorts of disturbances. Density may affect that by a few inches, but I don't think it's driving that, more than 10-foot difference that we're seeing in most of those cases. But a good hypothesis. So what other differences might we be seeing that's accounting for those 10 to 15 foot height differences? Genetics. I bet you genetics is playing a big role there. Because think about it, we haven't changed the soil, we haven't changed the climate very much between these two periods. But what we're seeing here, both those stands were 15 years old, they're the same age, but they're different heights. So if you estimated site index in those seed tree stands and then you came back and estimated site index in these plantations, would you get the same site index? When you looked it up on the site index curves, where you look up height, you look up age, you find the curve? No, you would think there was a higher site index in the plantations, even though they're growing in the same soil that those seed tree stands were in. And you would be right. Those stands are expressing a higher site index. So one factor there could absolutely be genetics, where when they planted these stands in 1984, they would have planted them with improved pines that we've been breeding since the 1950s in the South. And so think about it this way. You have the same soil, you have the same climate, but if your tree has better genetics, what that means is for a given pound of nitrogen in the soil, for a given pound of phosphorus in the soil, for a given amount of light that hits the leaves, for a given, inches of rainfall that go into that soil, that tree could grow taller and put on more volume. So genetics is one variable that can actually increase site index, even on the same site. So that kind of sounds counterintuitive, because we've always thought about site index as this fixed property of the site. Once you know site index, you know what that site can do. With modern intensive silviculture, we can actually manipulate sites. And if you think about it, we've kind of known that all along, because when you look at site index curves, so if I told you to go out and estimate site index on a hardwood stand, what would be one of the first questions you needed to ask me? So if I tell you, just go out, estimate site index on that, you know, that very last stand we were at in lab on Tuesday out there at Mill Pond Park. So you need to know how old the trees are. Well, we could have Sally increment bore them for us. She's got that down to a science. So we've got an age on them. What else would you need to know? So if you've got an increment borer in your hand and you're out at that particular stand and you're looking around, what's your first question going to be if you want a site index?
What species are you targeting?
What species? You need to know, am I coring sweet gum? And am I coring a mulberry? That'd be weird, right? You know, I don't think there are mulberry site index curves, but you need to know what species. And so here we're saying you can manipulate site index with silviculture, but part of that silviculture is changing the genetics, even though we haven't changed the species. But we've known all along that different species grow at different rates on the same site. So we've known all along that species is a very important factor in estimating site index. Okay, so I think genetics plays a big role there. There's probably some other minor factors, okay? So think about it. If you went out there in 1984 and you established a new stand with a seed tree versus a plantation, how old are the trees after their first growing season in the ground there in Louisiana? So in the seed tree, how old are they after a year? They're 1 year old. The seed has had to fall onto the seed bed, germinate in the spring, so probably germinating in March, April, May, and then it's grown up for a year. But on the plantation, if you go to that stand a year after you've planted seedlings, so say you planted the seedlings in January, how old are those seedlings if you go out there in December of that same year? They're 2 years old, because what would have happened, we would have sown that seed into a nursery if they're bare root seedlings or container seedlings. We would have gotten that seed germinated and growing, started that process around April around here. We would have grown them for a whole year in the nursery. Then the nursery would have sold you that 1 year old tree that's been through a growing season. You would have put it in the ground and it would have grown through another year. So the plantation trees are actually on average going to be about a year older. And it may even be more than that, because with that seed tree cut, you leave the seed trees out there for a period of 3 to 5 years. You might not get good regeneration. You might not have many germinating seedlings in that first year. It might be the second year where everything comes together and you get a good seed crop and the right environmental conditions to get that new cohort established. So even though these are both 15 years since establishment, those plantations might actually have slightly older trees in them, which would have given them a little bit of a head start. So, you know, height, pretty simple variable, but some complex stuff going on there explaining those differences. So what other differences do you see here between the plantations and the seed trees? Yeah, so if we look at basal area, basically the seed trees are all similar. We're seeing them all at 94, 95. But then, so let's think about silviculture in a plantation. Does more intensive silviculture work? And remember, they go from top to bottom in terms of least intensive to most intensive silviculture. It absolutely works. Your basal areas increase the more intensive your silviculture is out on this plantation. And some of it's kind of counterintuitive. Look at that first off option, the planted stand with mechanical site prep at 1,200 trees per acre versus the second line there below it, planted chemical site prep at 680 trees per acre. Would you think that if you planted almost half as many trees per acre, you would actually get more basal area after 15 years? That's kind of counterintuitive. Generally, the more trees per acre you have, the higher the basal area is going to be, but not in this example. So why is that? Why are you getting the higher basal area with fewer trees per acre? So what about it? Diameters? You can see they have larger diameters, so we know you calculate basal area from the diameter of your trees, squared times 0.005454 times how many trees there are, right? So the diameters are one part of it. What's the other part of it? Yeah, look at density-dependent mortality. Think about the exercise we did in class on Tuesday where you guys were kind of guesstimating how much density-dependent mortality there would be with stands planted at different densities. You can see it right there. They planted 1,200 trees per acre, but after 15 years, half of them have died, okay? And you can see the density is slightly lower where they only planted 680 trees per acre, but it's not lower by a lot. And when you think about the fact that basal area is going to be highly correlated to volume, you have more wood out on the stands where they planted fewer trees per acre. So I told you, you know, back in the 50s, we were planting 1,200 trees per acre. Now it's closer to 500. That's the reason why, okay? So if you're going to end up with about the same number of trees per acre halfway through your rotation, who wants to pay for an extra 600 seedlings at establishment? No one, okay? Why pay to put trees in the ground that are just going to die when instead you can plant half as many trees, get much better survival, and get more volume off that stand? So it just makes a lot more sense. Yeah, Katie.
So the trees per acre were calculated, they were all calculated at the end of the rotation?
So all of this is mid-rotation data. This is all 15-year-old stands. So it's looking at age 15 in the plantations versus age 15 in the clear cuts. And when we say age, we're talking about time since establishment, not the actual chronological age of the trees. Yeah. And so what we're thinking about here, when you look at all this data, this isn't the end of the rotation, this is the middle, okay? So the next thing we want to think about when we look at all these data is, what do we do next? If we're writing a prescription on these stands, what do we do next? And so general guidelines, and we're going to get to this more in lab, but general guidelines for getting your first thin into a pine plantation in the south, if we're going to thin the stand here, we have good markets for pulpwood and small dimension trees. And so there's really no reason to do a pre-commercial thin unless you absolutely have to, where you go in when the trees are real small and you cut them down and you just leave them out on the site, but you have to pay money to do that. You have to pay for the labor to do that. Often our first thins in the south are commercial thins, where you cut down trees that are big enough to make a product, you put them on a log truck, and you may be harvesting 30 tons per acre, for example. And so you're getting a truckload of pulpwood off each acre of land. The landowner's not gonna make a ton of money, but they will make some money. The operation will more than pay for itself. So you make a little bit of money and you improve the stand. But to get that first commercial thin in, you need to meet a variety of criteria. Your products are mostly gonna be pulpwood in that first thin. So we need a quadratic mean diameter in that stand of about 6 inches. If our average diameter is below 6 inches, the trees just aren't yet big enough to make pulpwood size class. We need the trees to be about 40 feet tall. And that's because here in the south, when you see the load of pulpwood driving down the road on the log truck, they're all tree length. And so to fit on that log truck, they need to be long enough that they're not gonna fall off, basically. So you need the trees to be about 40 feet tall. And then for a logger to be willing to do that operation, you need to remove between half a truckload and a truckload of wood per acre. So we're looking at removing between about 14 to 28 and a half tons per acre. And if all those conditions are met, it's probably time to pre-commercially thin that stand. Generally, you wanna see basal areas over 120 square feet. And on average, we're gonna thin down to somewhere between 60 and 80 square feet per acre, okay? So given those general guidelines, can you commercially thin these 15-year-old seed tree stands? It meets literally none of those criteria. You don't have volumes up there yet. I'll show you that in the next slide, but the trees are too small in diameter, the trees are too short, and the basal area is even suggesting it's not time to thin yet. You're not even over 120. 120 used to be kind of standard for once it gets over that thin, but now with better genetics, we can carry higher and higher and higher basal areas. Can you thin all those plantations commercially right now at age 15? You absolutely can, okay? So if you're looking at managing these stands to make money on timber, which option are you going with based on the data we've seen so far? The plantations make the most sense, okay? So I think we've covered most of what we have on this slide, but one more thing to look at. Let's say you do have a landowner that wants a seed tree, okay? There's lots of landowner objectives besides just managing timber and just making money. So a seed tree is still a perfectly viable option as long as it meets the landowner objectives. So let's look at how we do a seed tree, right, based on those three data points. So we have three options. You could just do the seed tree cut and that's it. You could do the seed tree cut and burn to prepare the seed bank, or you could do the seed tree cut and disc to prepare the seed bank. So on this particular site, under these conditions, which would you recommend? Okay, so Alejandro wants to burn. Someone always wants to burn, so.
Can you explain what disking is again?
Disking would be kind of like plowing in an agricultural context. Because there's stumps out there and slash, you may not be able to use a tractor and an ag disker, but you might have a dozer with similar sort of plow implements behind it that would till up the top 6 or so inches of the soil. Yeah, and again, the intent there is to expose mineral soil for seeds to fall on. And so that's gonna use a big dozer. In terms of cost, disking is the most expensive, burning is the second most expensive, and untreated, you're incurring no costs. Leave it untreated, why? Right.
With the disking, you risk destroying the seed tree.
Yeah, so there's almost no difference. And with disking, you could damage the root systems of your seed tree. So think about this in any other aspect of your life. Where else in your life do you spend money doing something to get nothing out of it? You know, maybe Disney World, but you know, that's about it. So you're not going to spend money on a treatment that doesn't gain you anything. Why fix a problem that's not a problem? So in this example, it would suggest that you shouldn't really need to do anything. Okay, so let's keep looking at this study. Here's some more data, and now we have volumes. This data is on volumes. And so let's look at the total amount that they're removing here. And when we look at this volume, you can see it's product volume, it's split into size classes. So we've got total volume, pulpwood volume, chip and saw volume, and saw timber volume, okay? And as we look at these different numbers here, they are in cubic feet per acre. So remember our conversion, 100 cubic feet per acre is equivalent to about 3 tons per acre of wood. So we can see basically the seed tree cuts are all getting us around 500 cubic feet per acre of pulpwood. They have no chip and saw size trees. They have no saw timber size trees at age 15. So 500 at 3 tons per 100 cubic feet, that means we have about 15 tons per acre out there. So even if you completely clear cut these stands at age 15, you're only getting half a truckload of wood per acre. Okay, so these stands do not have much volume out there right now. And then again, the same story that we saw on the last table plays out with the plantations. More intensive silviculture pays off. So again, this is age 15. So if you look, our planted stands at 1,200 trees per acre, our least intensive plantations, have 3 times the volume of total wood out there that the seed tree cuts do. So they have about 45 tons per acre. And then our more intensive options here at the bottom are gonna have, again, you have almost twice the volume just when you add herbicides to the mix and plant a few fewer trees, right? So that definitely pays off. And then you add herbaceous weed control in there and it pays off even more. Where now, when we look at that, you're looking at that most intensive plantation having over 100 tons per acre at age 15, okay? So that stand is doing really, really well. If you have 100 tons per acre out in your stand, can you remove 15 to 30 tons and keep growing that stand as a good productive stand that's using the full carrying capacity of that site? Absolutely, you're not removing too much there. But then look at the product class distribution. In our most intensive silvicultural system, you get about the same amount of pulpwood as you would on the seed trees. But the reason for that is that almost all your trees are bigger than pulpwood, right? And so you've got a whole bunch of chip and saw, and you even have a small amount of saw timber. You may not remove much or any of that saw timber in the first thin. If you were to thin the stand now, those are gonna be mostly your good crop trees at the end of the rotation, if they're already good saw timber trees. If some of them were saw timber size but forked or had other defects, you might consider removing them. And so the same story plays out here where the 3 different seed tree options, very little difference in volume. So why pay for site prep treatments you're not gonna use? And then on the plantations, more intensive silviculture works. And then if you have a landowner objective that is financial return, here's the financial data on this, okay? So you can see the different costs, the different revenues. And then really what I want to focus you on is this net present value column, okay? And so when we look at that net present value column, they've switched up the seed trees on us now. They have an option where they don't go back in and harvest the seed trees versus where they do go back in and harvest them. And you can see that they actually have a negative net present value there on not harvesting the seed trees. And it's because you didn't gain those revenues from harvesting them at age 5 in this stand. Because those trees are gonna be big, nice. You leave the best trees as your seed trees. So they lost out on the revenues from, you know, 5 to 10 of their best trees per acre. But look at that net present value column, and the same thing plays out in terms of money. Okay, so that's gonna be dollars per acre. If your landowner wants to make money, you tell them we can do a seed tree for you, you're gonna make money. Net present value of starting this plant, starting this forest this way, carrying it through the whole rotation, $92 an acre for you. You're gonna make $92 an acre. If you have 100 acres, you know, you're gonna make $9,000. That's good, right? Until you see the alternatives. Would you like to make, you know, on your 100 acre stand, would you like to make $9,000 or would you like to make $72,000? Okay, so much higher net present value. So those more intensive silvicultural treatments are more expensive in general. They're costing you more, okay? You can see the high cost on the seed tree because of a second logging operation. So the costs are actually represented as higher on there. But you know, as you look at just the plantations, it's costing you more for the more intensive silviculture, but it definitely pays for itself. There is one difference there. When you go from mechanical site prep to chemical site prep, we see our costs dropping by $30 an acre. Why did that cost drop? So mechanical site prep is generally more expensive than chemical site prep. That's one factor. What's the other factor up there? Yeah, they're paying for fewer trees per acre, right? So planting's gonna be a little cheaper because you had to buy fewer seedlings. So there you go. So basically this data really shows that if you've got a landowner out there that wants to manage timber and make money, a clear cut and a plantation is gonna get them more money than a clear cut, or not a clear cut, but a seed tree as your regeneration method. So we all agreed clear cutting was the most common. Here are some of the numbers that are explaining why clear cutting is the most common and why we don't drive down the road around here and, oh, there's a seed tree, there's a seed tree, there's another seed tree. Why we don't really see many seed trees. And I already showed you this the first day of class, but again, same take home message. Intensive silviculture costs money, but intensive silviculture grows you much more productive forests. It works. To give you an example of fertilizer, you know, Southwide fertilizer gets you a 25% growth response on your stand on average. And I've heard folks who work for different companies say that in East Texas, they've yet to see a stand where they can't make money by spending money on fertilizer. So it's gonna pay for itself over time. Okay, so you know, some of you already by this point, you know, 2 weeks into the semester are probably thinking, why do we have to keep talking about pine plantations, right? So let's talk a little bit about why we talk so much about pine plantations. And so I've got a picture up there for you. This is from a research plot. You rarely see an operational pine plantation that looks like that, where you've got complete weed control, extreme uniformity. So that's not really gonna be operational, but that's, you know, getting at the idea that these are much simpler ecosystems, okay? We're doing a prescription next week. It's gonna be your first prescription. Prescriptions are complex. It's real world problem solving. You have to account for a lot of different variables and constraints all at once. Would you rather I take you out to do your prescription on that stand right there or on a bottomland hardwood stand with 50 different tree species in it? You know, that's gonna be a simpler system. That's gonna be easier to manage in terms of the fact that it's easier to understand. And so one reason that we talk about pine plantation so much in this class is silviculture is complex. So as you're learning silviculture, it's easier to start with the simpler examples, figure out how they work, and then as we move along in the semester, we can get into more and more complex forest ecosystems and more complex silviculture that goes along with them. So, you know, it's easier to teach pine plantations. They're an agronomic model. You can kind of think of it as agriculture with trees, right? And they're gonna be more predictable. So we're gonna have a lab this semester where we use PTAIDA, where you can plug in data that we'll actually hopefully go measure on a real pine plantation, and you can predict how that stand's gonna grow over time. Okay, and it's got a pretty simple to use graphical user interface. I can teach it to you in one lab and you can be pretty proficient with it after one lab. I'd love to do that with hardwood stands. There are programs out there. There's freely available programs. The Forest Service has the Forest Vegetation Simulator, but because you're dealing with a mixed stand now, it's much more complex. It could probably take me 4 or 5 labs to teach you FVS. And so we're not gonna do that this semester just because we don't have time. And so, that more predictable, simpler system is one reason we talk about them so much. We have a ton of data on pine plantations. We have a lot of them. They're simple. People have been managing them. There's a lot of research on hardwoods as well, but think about it. You know, if you're focused just on lobelite pine plantations, every study you do on loblolly pine plantations is about loblolly pine plantations. If you're focused on managing bottomland hardwoods, now each study you do is going to be in a stand with a slightly different composition on a slightly different soil type, because soils are much more important in bottomland hardwoods in terms of matching the right species to the right site. You don't have a species like loblolly where you can throw it at a bunch of different soils and it grows well on all of them. And so we have a lot more data on these pine plantations because they're simple, they're homogenous. It's all one species we're talking about for the most part. So they grow fast. You know, we're planting them for a reason. If you look at many other countries in the world, if you were to go to Chile, South Africa, New Zealand, Australia, and you know, Brazil, you look at their forest plantations, they don't have a bunch of native species out there like we do here in the US South. We got lucky where we have a native tree species to our region that can make the products that we want to make and that grows faster than about anything else we can grow here. Not many other places in the world are quite that lucky where they have all those factors come together. So if you go to Chile or Brazil, they're planting a lot of loblolly pine, among other species. Eucalyptus from Australia, right? If you go to South Africa, they're planting radiata pine. If you go to New Zealand, they're planting radiata pine, so which is from California. So we got lucky here that we have a fast-growing native that works well. And because it's growing fast, you have short rotations. And because we're in a part of the world where, you know, we have 100-degree summers, we have, you know, nine-month growing seasons or more, you know, we can afford to do more. That gives us shorter rotations, which means we can afford to pay for a lot of herbicide, a lot of fertilizer, put a lot of prescribed fire out on the ground. So we have a lot of these different resources. So we can use all these different treatments. Okay, but you will hear a lot of different arguments against pine plantations. So I just want to go over some of those and look at them with a little bit more detail. So you often hear arguments like this, where, you know, plantations are monocultures. They have all one species of tree, and so they're even-aged. You have all about one age class of trees. And if you think about what we're doing, how many pine plantations make it from stand initiation to stem exclusion to understory reinitiation? Do they make it through there? If you think about what we're doing, if we're managing these stands on 25-year rotations, we initiate the stand, we get them into stem exclusion, and then what do? We reset succession artificially by clear cutting and replanting. So most of them aren't even really making it all the way into understory reinitiation. So we're just dealing with a brief period of the full range of stand dynamics where we don't have a lot of those structures that you would associate with older forests and understory reinitiation or old growth. You'll hear people call plantations biological deserts, just getting at the idea that, you know, wildlife habitat may not be great for many species in them. We're using herbicides, so there's lots of folks that, you know, aren't very comfortable with herbicides. And then, you know, in a plantation, if you're going on that short rotation, you know, your trees, you know, you're not getting 2 foot DBH trees. You're getting, you know, 1 foot DBH trees because they're younger, and a smaller tree stores less carbon than a bigger tree, right? So you may not be storing as much carbon. We don't have as much deadwood out there that's storing carbon, right? If you go into a plantation, there's not a big down dead 2 foot diameter log because you didn't grow a tree that big and allow it to die and fall down. So you hear a lot of these arguments, but what you have to think about is the comparison. Usually when you see these studies, they're comparing this plantation forest to some old growth reserve they've found, like the Mill Creek Cove site that we go to most years at Field Station. Many of you may have seen on a video this year at Field Station. So they compare that to this pine plantation. And when you make that comparison, you know, there's no question. You know, the old growth stand has more of a lot of these ecological variables of interest than the plantation does. But making that comparison is key. So if we go out and we look at a plantation, you look at that stand we were at, the varietal pine plantation we were at on the Foshi property, okay? If that was not a pine plantation, would that stand here in Nacogdoches County be an old growth forest? Look at our land use history. European settlers came through here in the 17, 1800s and even into the early 1900s and harvested all the trees. They logged it out, okay? That had nothing to do with silviculture. That had nothing to do with forest management. That was just mining timber, basically. Before we really had any clue what we were doing. And so, you know, the old growth forests were gone. They're not coming back in 100 years, okay? So if that was not going to be an old growth forest, what might it actually have been? agriculture, maybe. You know, that could be pasture land, that could be some sort of agriculture field. You know, plantations don't look great versus old growth, but they look a heck of a lot better than a Walmart parking lot. They look a heck of a lot better. What are we losing most of our forest land to in the South each year right now? Urbanization. So they look a whole lot better than a landscape made up of a whole bunch of houses and driveways with a lot of impermeable surface area that's going to run off. And then you've got everyone with their yard that they're putting herbicides and fertilizers out on four times a year. So a plantation, you know, we may put fertilizers out three times over 30 years. We may put herbicides out twice over 30 years. So when you start comparing plantations against agricultural land, urban land, which are realistic alternatives, not old growth forests, on almost all those variables at the top, they are better, okay? They give you better water quality, better air quality, more carbon sequestration, that everything you're looking at, they're an improvement. So basically any forest is going to be an improvement over any other land use for these variables, even if it is a very, very simple forest. So that comparison is going to be key. They're not old growth forests, but that, you know, even prior to European settlement, the whole southern United States was not 100% old growth forest. Old growth forests would have been less common because we still had hurricanes. We had a lot more fire out on the landscape. So you had lots of disturbances leading areas to be in earlier stages of stand development. Okay, there's lots of production arguments for plantations. And so, you know, these are agricultural systems. We're producing a commodity as efficiently as possible, okay? So what percentage of the world's forests do you all think are in plantations? So let's just get shows of hands who thinks it's 50% of the world's forests are plantations. Nobody? 75%? Anybody higher? Got one for 75? 25%? I'm getting some, maybe 15%? 10%? Got a few for that. It turns out it's actually 5%. 5% of the world's forests are in plantations. What percentage of our wood products do you think come from those 5% of our forests? So I heard someone say a number somewhere over here.
75.
So 75%. So who thinks it's higher than 75%? Got a few people thinking it's higher. Who thinks it's lower? A lot of people don't know. It turns out it's about a third. Okay. So we get a third of our forest products from a 20th of our forests. Okay. So if you think about it on that context, we're using 5% of our forest to produce a third of what we want from timber out of our forests. What does that mean we can do with the other 95% of our forests? We can have other objectives besides timber have much greater importance on them. So if we can really crank productivity up on a small percentage of our forests, that's going to allow us to manage the other vast majority of our forests on longer rotations, with more biological complexity, with more carbon sequestration, with everything else we want out from our forests. You know, think about the national forest system where you've got recreation, water, range, all these other things that they are required under the Multiple Use Sustained Yield Act to manage our national forests for. You know, they're not getting all that on 1 acre, okay? They're getting that across the broad forest landscape. And so managing some areas very intensively for timber makes sense. It gives you more flexibility everywhere else. And then you also have to keep in mind that wood products are sustainable when we practice silviculture appropriately, and you can manage pine plantations sustainably. And then from an economic standpoint, these numbers are relatively recent. I think I updated them, so they would have been 2017, 2016 numbers maybe. But we're talking about huge industries that produce lots of jobs and lots of revenue in many of these states. Okay, so when we talk about ecosystem services, you know, plantations, you know, do produce clean water. And so when you look at every study, we've got a lot of studies out there on what happens when you fertilize a pine plantation in the South, looking at stream water quality. You're going to get a brief pulse in more nitrogen in the stream because you just put a bunch of nitrogen down over the whole site, right? But it's very brief and it's very small, okay? We've all heard about eutrophication, that large dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico, from over-fertilization. But if you think about it, what's the thing that we do in forestry to improve water quality? what are our tools to improve water quality? Stream side management zones. So what is a stream side management zone in its simplest form? It's trees by a stream, right? So what is a plantation? Trees by a stream, right? And so a lot of the nutrients that are getting into our waters and causing these major problems are coming again from agricultural and urban land uses, not from forests. Even if you have one of these very intensively managed forests with one species out there, you're gonna get better water quality off that than all these other land use. And then, you know, even though you don't have those large trees sequestering carbon, if you think about it, when we harvest those plantations, the carbon doesn't just vanish, okay? The carbon goes into forest products. We saw 2x4s out of those trees. Those 2x4s go into a wall in a house, and that house hopefully makes it, you know, 50, 100 years. And so the half-life of our forest products is about 5 years, which means half of that carbon is back in the atmosphere after about 5 years. You guys all have paper sitting in front of you. That's gonna have a shorter half-life, right? But that means half of it may be sequestered for a much longer time period. So we're not just storing carbon in the trees, but we're storing carbon in the products that we make from the trees. And those products go into all sorts of stuff. You know, there's forest products that go into flat screen TVs. They get all sorts of chemicals out of trees at pulp mills that are used in all sorts of different applications. So, okay, we've got a successional argument that you can make for plantations as well. If everything was old growth, you know, where do your species that need early successional habitat go? Okay, so for folks that like to hunt deer, is a clear cut a bad thing? No, that's where you put your stand, right? So there are a lot of wildlife that prefer or even need early successional habitats. And so if we're managing an area with a lot of harvesting, even a lot of clear cutting, that's gonna provide those early successional habitats that we wouldn't have otherwise. Again, think back to prior to European settlement. What factor in the South would have been providing a lot of those early successional habitats around here? What was that, Alejandro?
Fire,
right? We had a lot more fire on the landscape. That's gonna give you more early successional habitat. Well, we've largely removed that for a lot of different reasons, right? And so this can help us build back in those early successional habitats. And again, it's still gonna be a small percentage of our land base. We're clear cutting a lot, right? But again, if you have a company that owns 1 million acres of forest, and on average, they're keeping it in 25 year rotations on pine plantations, that means in any given year, they're only harvesting about 4% of their area. And then you've got 4% in 1 year old stands, give or take. And so that gives you, you know, 10% or less of your stands that are in these, you know, really young age classes. So it's still not the majority of our landscape. When you hear people talk about biological deserts, like that stand on the left, you know, that's gonna be a stand and stem exclusion. But what we realize as foresters is that whether it's pine, whether it's mixed hardwoods, whatever the species is, any even age stand is going to go through stem exclusion, okay? When you walk out into a 20-year-old mixed hardwood stand, there may not be much wildlife habitat value. Think about the overcup oak flat we were out on for lab last week. That's about a 65-year-old stand now. Was there much wildlife habitat quality out on that? There was no browse. Overcup oak doesn't produce acorns that are preferred by many species. There wasn't much food. There just wasn't much there. So some even age stands that are naturally regenerated, mixed, hardwoods, all sorts of other species may not have much habitat value either. So, one solution to that is to move them in an uneven age direction. And we can certainly do that. There are a lot of people working on that. But compared to other even age stands, plantations really aren't that different. Okay, the other argument you'll often hear is they're coming in, they're cutting all the hardwoods down, and they're planting pine plantations. Okay, we're converting all these great hardwood stands to plantations. This is actual data from the southern US, and you can see it goes from 1953 on into the 2000s. This is total acreage in our different forest cover types. And what you'll notice is most of these lines are gonna be relatively flat, okay? We are losing some bottomland hardwoods, that is dropping, but we tend to be losing those mostly to urban development, agriculture. We're not really losing them, converting them to pine plantations. But you see one clear line very much on the rise there, that's our plantation pines. and you see one clear line that's dropping rapidly. They look like mirror images, right? And if you look at what that dropping line is, that's our natural pine stands. So we're not replacing all our hardwoods with planted pine. We're replacing all our naturally regenerated pine with planted pine. So we're not totally changing the composition of these ecosystems out of pine. They were pine ecosystems before, many of them. We have changed the species. Longleaf would have been much, much more prevalent on the landscape. Loblolly would have been a lot less prevalent on the landscape. But unless we really want to reintroduce fire on a scale that's just extreme, that's not going to come back. You need that fire to make longleaf much more, you know, much greater in abundance and loblolly much less in abundance. Okay, so let's look a little bit more about the actual forest resources we have here in East Texas, and let's think a little bit about how we're managing them. Are we doing that sustainably? How's it going? And so I took this from 2008 FIA data, Forest Inventory and Analysis. So a lot of our graduates actually collect this data. So for example, Zach Ovalgon right now graduated a few years ago. He's working for TFS down in Lufkin. And he goes out and he measures these plots. For those of you that went to a face-to-face field station, you put in some of these plots during Land Resources Week. Hopefully for those that went to the half online field station, you'll be doing that, you know, one weekend soon, we'll see. But we're looking at about 12 million acres of forest. They classify 99% of it as timberland. Texas has about 60 million acres of forest, but 50 million of that is woodlands west of East Texas, and that's really not classified as timberland. No one's managing those stands for timber, right? But you can manage pretty much all our forests in East Texas for timber. Here's who owns them, okay? We are heavily dominated in the South by non-industrial private forest landowners, okay? We also have a lot of industry. So you can see 20% industry, but we have very, very little public land. So you can see the US forests make up the national forests make up most of our public land, a little bit of other federal land like our national wildlife refuges, and then a little bit of state and local land. So heavily dominated by private land. When you look at our cover types, we have about 20% pine plantations here in East Texas. So Southwide average is about 15%. So we do have a lot of pine plantations here, but probably not as much as you would have thought. It's only a fifth of our stands. If you're going to have a pine plantation and manage it, what do you want it to be close to? You want it to be close to the mill, which means it's also close to what? How do you get the trees to the mill? You need it close to a road. So, you know, you're probably not going to be locating pine plantations far away from roads because that doesn't make sense. And so we probably think there's more pine plantations than 20% because they're all by the roads, because that's what makes sense from a management standpoint. But you can also see, I kind of have pines on the left, hardwoods on the right. We're kind of 50-50 divided between pine and hardwoods. So we are called the piney woods, but you could just as easily call East Texas the hardy woods. You know, that other slice there is probably tallow. It probably needs to be bigger than that. So we've got some pretty diverse forests. So let's look at a few of these graphs, looking at how much wood do we have, how fast is it growing, and how much are we removing. And these are going to look like they're dominated by pine. So you can see the tallest bar there near the far left is going to be the loblolly shortleaf column. But it's not as dominated by pine as you think, because hardwoods have a lot more species. So it's a greater number of bars that are all shorter. So if you look to the far right, you can see that we've got about 9 net growing stock there is in billion cubic feet. So we have about 9 billion cubic feet of pine out there. We have about 7 billion cubic feet of hardwood out there. That's kind of a meaningless number. Like, that's hard to wrap your head around. I don't think any of us can really understand what that is. So I've broken it down in a few other ways. If we clear cut East Texas today, we would need 18 million truckloads to haul it to the mill. So we've got 18 million truckloads of wood out there. So still a pretty abstract number, but that makes it a little more understandable maybe. Okay, so here's how it's growing, okay? And if I flip back to what's out there, you can see these different colors of the ownership. So the dark green on top of there is the federal ownership. And so you can see the federal ownership, even though it's only 8% of our land, they've got quite a bit of pine. And that's not a surprise to anyone that's been out on any of our national forests. Lots of big pines out there. And then look at the company land. The company land has quite a bit of pine as well. In terms of how it's growing low, if we look at that, our federal lands are really not growing pine very fast. Why is that? So how old is our average pine stand on our Forest Service land? Is it 25? 70 or 80, right? They're older stands, they've reached maturity, so they're just not growing as fast anymore. We skipped the EcoPhys lecture where we look at logistic growth curves, but I'll work that into a lab later so we can, you know, see how that plays out a little bit more. But then look at the industry land. They're growing a lot of pine pretty quick. Basically, they're growing it through the fastest period of a rotation, then they're clear cutting and continuing to grow the next rotation in that really fast early growth phase of a rotation. And so they just keep growth at its maximum. They're not keeping volume at its maximum. And so we have a lot of growth there. Our hardwoods have about half the growth. But again, these are kind of abstract numbers. We're now in millions of cubic feet. But if we break this down, if we just cut the growth on our forest land in East Texas, we can load 1.1 million log trucks a year with wood. And we're sustainably harvesting. All we're doing is taking what grew in the last year. Okay? So, you know, we see a lot of log trucks on the road, but that doesn't mean we're just, you know, destroying our resource here. We're growing a lot of wood here in East Texas. And so here's what we're removing. And what you'll notice first off is those federal columns vanished. So they're doing a little bit of timber harvest on our national forest, not much. And then most of our other federal lands, just really no harvesting to speak of. Industry is harvesting a lot. Non-industrial private forest landowners, which again are 70% of our land, are doing the majorities of our harvest around here. And if we look at it, remember, we can sustainably harvest a million truckloads of wood per year. We're actually harvesting about 800,000 truckloads of wood per year. So are we managing our forest sustainably? Yeah. What we're seeing southwide, we are losing land to urbanization, but overall we still have more wood than we used to have. We're still growing our forests in the south faster than we're harvesting them. Okay? And so I did some back of the envelope calculations. That's kind of equivalent to 200,000 acres being clear cut, but that involved a lot of assumptions. That assumes we're not doing any thinning. We're doing lots of thinning. That assumes every acre has, you know, 5 truckloads of wood per acre. I think I used four truckloads of wood per acre there, but so it's making some assumptions, but it's oversimplified a little. But again, think about that. So all our removals would be equivalent to about 200,000 acres of clear cut, but 200,000 out of 12 million, okay? And so when you think about it that way, that means that we've got our average site in East Texas, not on a 25-year rotation, but if you look at 12 million divided by 200,000, that's gonna be a 60-year rotation on average, okay? So our average rotation is pretty long because again, only 20% of our land base is in pine plantations that are on that much shorter rotation. A lot of our other stands are on a longer rotation. And then if you start looking at what we're doing in the South compared to the nation, this is a study from the early 2000s by the Forest Service. And so that's how this study defined the regions. I don't think anyone in San Diego would consider themselves to be living in the Pacific Northwest, but this is how these regions broke down in the study. But in terms of roundwood equivalents, here's timber harvesting across the country. The U.S. South harvests more country than all the rest of the, harvests more wood than all the rest of the country combined. And in fact, the U.S. South is the wood basket of the world. We harvest more wood than any other country on earth. So our pine plantations are a big part of that. They're very effective. And you see that really play out in terms of softwood removals. We're almost up to 2/3 of the country in terms of supplying softwoods. And you can see some of these regions don't have very productive softwoods. The Midwest, that's a hardwood region. So they provide almost none. The Rockies, you know, very long rotations there. Pacific Northwest, and that's gonna be dominated by Douglas fir. And then if you look at hardwoods, we're still at almost half, but some of those other regions like the Midwest and the Northeast do pretty well on hardwoods and produce some pretty high value hardwoods. And so this is from a different study out of 2005, but if you start looking at it and breaking down a little bit further, this is pulpwood. And so you can see on the left, the softwood pulpwood is in blue, and then the hardwood pulpwood is in red there on the right. But nationwide, what we're pulling in is about 2/3 of the pulpwood coming from softwoods, about 1/3 coming from hardwoods. But then what I've done for you on the right, that's just the South. So we're even more dominant in the softwood pulpwood in the South, 70% to 30%. But then those little percentages in white on the bottom right, the US South is providing 84% of the softwood pulpwood in the country. Okay, so we really dominate the softwood pulpwood markets, and we're providing 68% of the hardwood pulpwood. So very dominant there. Here's sawtimber. So sawtimber is even more dominated by softwoods, where it's about 3/4 nationwide of the sawtimber is coming from softwoods. Even more so in the South, 80% of the sawtimber is coming from softwoods in the South. But if you look there, the U.S. South is providing 45% of the softwood sawtimber, and it's providing 39% of the hardwood sawtimber in the country. So, and again, you drive around here anywhere, you see mills everywhere, right? So, good reason for that. And then with hardwoods, you know, we've got these diverse hardwood resources. That is the other half of our composition. And you can see heavily dominated by what, sweet gum, water oak, pretty common there. So no surprise, but we have a lot of different species out in our hardwoods. And we know around here, you know, we're dominated by private land, right? So we're not, when we're managing our forests, going through NEPA policies where we're preparing environmental impact statements very much, because that's required on federal land by federal agencies. Those aren't our landowners. So we're not dealing with a lot of those societal factors, but that doesn't mean we don't have any societal factors. Herbicide use anywhere in the country is federally regulated. So that's one example where societal factors are coming into play. But even if you're just clear cutting private land, okay, we know most of our land around here is either hunted or leased for hunting. And so, you know, you can clear cut pine plantations all day on land that's leased by hunters. The companies do it all the time. You know, they don't get many complaints. It's not a big deal. Everyone knows that's going to happen, right? But if you go and you clear cut a hardwood stand, you know, now you've cut down a stand that, you know, you've got a family with 3 generations, you just cut down their squirrel hunting spot, and, you know, you get a lot more complaints. So the companies, you know, they have folks that deal with the hunters that are leasing their land, and, you know, you talk to those folks, and it's a big difference between pine and hardwoods there. So there are societal factors even on our industry land, even on our private land. And so the bottom line on all this, it's not that plantations are right or wrong. They're just, you know, they're a tool. They're a silvicultural solution to a problem, growing timber fast, right? So it's not that they're right or wrong. It's just, are they appropriate or inappropriate for the landowner objectives and the values we need from a forest? On some sites, pine plantations are not a good idea. If your site, you know, floods, not a good idea to put a pine plantation out there. They're unlikely to survive. If you've got a site like that Mill Creek Cove old growth site, that's a unique and rare site around here. We don't need to be replacing it with a pine plantation. We need to be preserving that as best we can. So they're right in many areas, wrong in some areas, but it's really just, is it appropriate for that area or not? That's what you're really looking at. You can't broadly generalize about, is this a good tool or a bad tool? And again, keep in mind, we need a lot of diversity out there, but we don't need it all on 1 acre. By diversifying what we do on each acre of land, that's how we build in real diversity in our forests. And so we've got a lot of plantations here in the southern U.S. We've got a lot of plantations in East Texas, and we've seen why it makes sense to do these with clear cut and plant, and why we're not doing seed trees everywhere, why we don't have much patch selection, group selection, two-age systems. We've seen the data on that. We also have a lot of hardwood resource in the South, and it often makes sense, and we'll get into this more and more this semester as we build complexity into the class, it makes a lot of sense to naturally regenerate those areas, manage them on longer